Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Dark Eternity by Nissa Leader, narrated by Jesse Vilinsky. Chapter 1. The scent of paper filled the dark library. With a mere thought, Scarlett lit three candlesticks placed on the back desk and closed the door behind her. Soon the sun would rise and her duties as queen would begin, but for now, she enjoyed some time to herself. On the other side of the desk, on the bottom shelf of the tall bookcase, Scarlett pulled out four books and set them on the ground. They weren't the books she wanted. Behind them, she'd hidden the one she needed. She carefully lifted it onto the desk. It was a large book made of black leather. Intricate gold stars of different shapes and sizes were etched into the cover and surrounded the quarter moon carved into the center. Scarlett hovered her hand, now tattooed in white ink, with a sun-like flower in its center, connected to a vine pattern that circled her wrist like a bracelet, over the book's top. She closed her eyes and felt it. A coolness swam through her veins as she inhaled. She flipped it open and traced her fingers over the spells inside. Magic radiated from the crisp paper like heat from a fire. Some of the other books in the library possessed small sparks of magic, but this was the only book she'd found that felt powerful. The rest were filled with the realm's history, children's fairy tales, poems of love and loss, stories of adventure, and any other kind of book one might find in a mortal library. But none of them fascinated Scarlett like this one. Every morning, she started her day before morning light at the desk reading the book. Like every book in the library, a different language filled the pages. Before she'd absorbed the tree's power, it would have seemed foreign. But now, she read it with ease as if it were written in her native tongue. She had spent countless hours entranced by the magical book over the past 2 weeks, since learning she was the queen of this unknown realm. Something told her others might not approve of whatever the book was. Whenever anyone found her, she claimed to be studying. She needed to know more about the realm if she wanted to be a good queen to its people. It wasn't a complete lie, but the truth was, she didn't want to be queen. 2 weeks ago, she was the weakest of her group, not allowed to do anything more than hold a stupid compass. Now she was somehow supposed to be a ruler? Instead of worrying, she let the book consume her. As she flipped through its crisp pages, any uneasiness in her new position or fear of the enemies she'd gained since discovering the Fae world flew far away, replaced with a trance as she focused on the words in front of her. Today, she read a spell about stealing someone's breath. Morbid, but the more morbid something was, the more likely she was to need it these days. A knock startled her. How long had she been in the library? The warm glow of sunrise shined into the room. She'd been there a while. Scarlett hurriedly slid the book back into its hiding spot and returned to her seat at the desk. Come in. Rowan, dressed in black fighting leathers, entered. Her dark hair was pulled into a bun. The solemn expression on her face reminded Scarlett of the events that occurred after she'd absorbed the power from the life tree, when Raith had sacrificed himself to save his mother's life. Rowan wore her guilt in the dark circles underneath her eyes. Scarlett had offered to share the assortment of dresses she'd found in Donna's closet, but Rowan politely declined. Truthfully, Scarlett would have refused them too if she could have, but Vita suggested the people would be more comfortable with Scarlett as queen if she resembled their former ruler, who apparently was Scarlett's long-lost grandmother. She hadn't admitted it to anyone, but the thought of ruling others brought nausea to her stomach. She might have some new great power in her, but she didn't know how to use it. She barely knew how to take care of herself. All she ever did was let people down. Although she wasn't the same weak mortal so easily lured into fairy, sometimes she felt just as worthless as she had, standing upon the hill, too afraid to visit her mother's grave. There was one benefit to her new authority. At least no one would tell her what she could or couldn't do now. A refreshing change.
Vida and the other council members have gathered in the throne room.
Rowan glanced to the empty table.
Is everything okay?
Rowan's blue eyes reminded Scarlett of Raith, sending a pang of sorrow to her chest. She stood and smoothed out her long ivory dress.
I enjoy the feel of the library.
She grinned as nonchalantly as she could. I'm still adjusting to everything.
Of course you are.
Rowan's gaze dropped.
I'm sure this is all incredibly overwhelming.
Just a bit.
But it is what it is.
Scarlett shrugged. Probably not a very queen-like gesture, but oh well. Better not make them wait too long. Though she hadn't mastered it yet, after receiving the life tree's power, Scarlett had gained the ability to evanesce. She'd always hated the queasy feeling it gave her, but she had to admit it was an efficient way to travel. So far, she'd only been able to evanesce from one room to an adjacent one. She considered trying to make it to the throne room, but reconsidered. Walking was slower, and she was in no hurry to sit in front of anyone and pretend she knew how to protect them from the fates. She hadn't even been able to save Raith. Rowan remained silent as she kept a few steps behind Scarlett. From the moment Raith had sacrificed himself, a constant wave of shame surrounded her. After doing so much to save him, he'd been the one to save her. His mother had put her energy into helping Scarlett in any way she could, which Scarlett appreciated. She felt most comfortable around Rowan, who treated her half-normal. Everyone else treated her like royalty. Despite the fact that she was, it still freaked her out. The hallway was wide, nearly as wide as Scarlett's bedroom growing up. Windows, mostly rectangular, save for their rounded tops, lined the walls, allowing light to shine in. Quite the change from the dark library Scarlett spent her morning in. As the sunshine soaked into her skin, it warmed her. And not only in the normal way she'd felt when she and Natalie would spend their summers bathing in the rays, desperate for a tan, but in a way that made her feel powerful. The thought of Natalie tightened her chest. What was her best friend doing? Did she worry about Scarlett? Or did she have a new best friend to go shopping with, or stay up late with, giggling over the silliest things? She approached a tall wooden door, shaped like the hallway windows. Floral and geometric designs, like those on her arms, were carved into the white wood. The same pattern was carved into the stone border surrounding the door. Every detail of the castle was perfect. From the stone floor to the high ceilings, Scarlett had yet to see a blemish or place where attention to detail had been spared. And it was her castle. Would she ever get used to it? She remembered the awe that struck her when she first entered Fairy with Cade. Despite the overwhelming grief she carried, the grandeur of the world made her feel like a princess. Whenever she wasn't too numb to feel anything, that was. He'd needed her emotion, and she quickly learned she was no Cinderella to him. But now the magic and castle belonged to her. The previous queen, Dunna, had sacrificed her magic and become mortal to postpone a vision she'd seen. The other world had mostly belonged to Dunna, but the darkest part of the realm, called the Darkland, belonged to Anku, father to the Fates who had stolen Raith. Scarlett hesitated outside the door. Maybe she should evanesce back to the library and walk back. It would be good practice. She sighed. Putting it off wouldn't change the result. She had to meet the council. Might as well get it over with. She inhaled before entering the throne room. The two rows of people created a path to the rose-gold throne at the front of the room.
Scarlett held her breath as she walked past everyone, finally exhaling when she made it to the throne. When she turned and faced the crowd, they bowed, then shifted to stand in front of her. Scarlett resisted the urge to cross her arms, a nervous habit she'd always had. She kept them pinned to her sides, allowing herself to run her thumbs over the tips of her fingers.
"My queen,"
Vida spoke from the front of the group. "Hello, Vida." Scarlett smiled as she sat. She wasn't sure if queens were supposed to smile at their subjects in this realm, but she felt awkward, so smiling it was.
"We've come with information regarding the Fates. A few of my tribe members snuck to the barrier entrance between our side of the realm and Anku's. As we suspected, it's well guarded with his creatures."
So they'd found nothing? What good was meeting to tell her they'd failed? Anger rose in Scarlett's throat. She clenched her fists. What was wrong with her? They'd tried. What did she expect them to do? Die needlessly? Scarlett inhaled and exhaled slowly, releasing the wrath inside of her. "Any news of my friend?" She nervously bit her lip. Scarlett could sense the anxiousness exuding from Rowan in the back of the room. With her heightened powers, sensing emotion had become second nature to her. Her gaze met Rowan's, and she saw the fear she felt reflected in Rowan's eyes.
"None yet. But I know them. They didn't take him to kill him, or they would have done it in front of you."
How reassuring. Scarlett tapped her fingertips on the cold metal of the throne. She was hopeful Raith was still alive, but that didn't mean he was safe. They could be torturing him for information as she sat here doing nothing. "What do you suggest we do? Sit here and wait for them to attack us?" Scarlett's tone was harsher than she intended. "I don't like feeling helpless."
"We'll try again."
Param, the half-goat, half-human man, which Scarlett learned was called a satyr, who'd quizzed Scarlett and Kaelem before allowing them to go to the tree, stepped forward, his hooves clicking against the tiles. His large horns that curved backward from his head made him seem taller and regal. He served on the council as head of the guard. "The protections we have in place to keep the Fates away are still holding strong. We will continue to maintain them and research other methods to keep you safe at all times."
"Thank you, Param."
Next, Ailani, the satyr who'd protected the entrance to the life tree the others had gone through, stepped forward. She was the head of communications with the Shi people.
"The people are excited to once again have a queen. They've been dropping off gifts, which we've stored in the castle's ballroom. They are eager to meet you and shower you with their appreciation in person, my queen."
"Thank you, Ailani. I'm grateful for their kindness." And she was. It was just too much for her to think about right then. How could she look into their eyes with no idea how to be the queen they deserved? She didn't want to lie to them by making promises she couldn't keep. Once Scarlett had been updated by the other council members, she excused everyone. "Vida," Scarlett said, "would you stay for a few more minutes?"
"Of course, my queen."
"You can just call me Scarlett," she said as everyone else left the room.
"You are the queen now,"
Vida said.
"Allow us to treat you as such."
Scarlett dipped her chin. Maybe someday being called queen wouldn't seem so strange. "I want to know more about the Fates." Vida pressed her lips shut as she stared at Scarlett. Reluctance filled her aura, but she asked,
"What would you like to know?"
"Were they always out for power?" The question had been bothering Scarlett for a while. If they already had magic, why go to such lengths for more? Was it greed, or was there more to it?
"Dana and their father, Anku, were the first Shi. Legend says they were born of darkness and light to create balance, with magic to have and share. Dana never had children, but Anku fell in love and had triplet girls. His lover died in childbirth, and Anku vowed never to love again. The girls were raised by his servants, hidden in the Darkland, the otherworld's land of death. When they grew into adults, they left their father and joined the outside otherworld, and lived peacefully for many years.
Were they normal? The fates that Scarlett knew sent a tingle across her skin. They'd always creeped her out with their ominous words and black eyes. She couldn't picture them any less creepy.
Yes. I'm not sure how they became what they are now.
So, Dana was the queen of the Otherworld, but not the Darkland?
Correct. Although the Darkland is part of the realm known as the Otherworld, it belongs to Anku. Dana represented life. She could not rule a land of death.
Scarlett wanted to know more, but she excused Vita. It was so much to take in that she didn't want to overwhelm herself. She'd sensed Vita's apprehension to disclose too much. Did Vita not trust Scarlett? Or did she sense her worry and not want to add more to it? Scarlett returned to the library. She wanted to crawl into bed and sleep for a decade. But since that wouldn't solve anything, she resisted the temptation. Instead, she allowed herself some time to her thoughts. What were the fates after? What could have turned them into creatures that would steal someone's heart as they had Wraith's? There was so much she didn't know. Whatever the reason, Scarlett was determined to get him back. She saw the spark in everyone's eyes when they talked about Dana. Dana was the perfect queen. Kind, smart, beautiful. She sacrificed her own immortality to protect her people for as long as possible. How was Scarlett supposed to live up to her? Chapter 2. It had been a month since Kaelem returned to the Unseelie Court, where time moved faster than it did in the other world. He was glad to be home, but everything felt a bit different than before. He stood outside Arya's door, listening to the giggling inside her room. Lurking like that was a little creepy, yes, but he had missed hearing his sister's laugh. The image of her rotting away in the winter prison was burned into his brain. He could only hope someday it would vanish. Kaelem knocked.
"Come in,"
Arya said. When he entered, he saw Arya and Ashley sitting on the couch, watching the TV that hung above the fireplace. Arya smiled at him. Ashley looked the other way.
Ugh, why is he here?
Ashley's thoughts were an open book. Kaelem couldn't blame her for her distaste of him, and he didn't have the energy to change her mind, nor did he care to. There were more pressing issues. The mortal would be wise to realize the world did not, in fact, revolve around her or her desires.
"I need to steal you away for a few minutes," he said to Arya.
"I'll be back," she said to Ashley.
"Pause the show?"
"Of course." Ashley grabbed the remote and clicked the pause button. Arya followed Kaelem to his TV room. He shut the door behind them and reached his mind out to make sure no one else remained within hearing distance.
"What's with the look of defeat, brother?"
Arya asked.
"You aren't one to be so dismal."
It was true. Normally, instead of being stressed about something, he'd find his way to one of the hottest clubs downtown. A few drinks and a few women tended to do a good job of distracting him. But that was when his problems weren't so damn big. Losing his sister had been the worst, but a looming war made even that seem small scale. Kaelem tilted his head.
"You missed my last dismal phase."
"Oh, right,"
Arya plopped onto the leather couch.
I suppose me being locked in a winter prison might have upset you.
Kaelem sat in the white, high-backed chair opposite Arya and lifted his feet to the matching ottoman.
I hated myself for letting you get taken. I vowed never to let anything like it happen again.
He crossed his right ankle over his left.
It was a one-time thing. I'd learned my lesson. I was the strongest Fae except for Genevieve, and I knew I could hold my own against her if I ever needed to. But now, with the Fates on the loose and no idea what they plan to do, I'm worried.
Who are you, and what have you done with my self-assured brother?
Arya quipped. Kaelem laughed.
Please, I have plenty of self-assurance left. I'm simply trying to tone down my confidence a little bit. I don't want to be as blind to outside threats as Father was.
Arya pulled her legs into the couch in a crisscross. Her hair almost reached her chin now, and the pinkness in her cheeks had finally fully returned.
You didn't bring me here just to tell me you don't know what to do, did you?
I've had all the magical wards I can think of put up around the palace to keep the Fates out. They were the only ones who never needed permission to get in here. It never bothered me before. They were odd, yes, but seemed harmless. Now they're a threat. I don't know what they're capable of, but they're smart. They took Raith and must have a plan for him. I worry they might come for Ashley next.
I won't let them take her.
Arya pulled her shoulders back the way she always did when she meant what she said.
You might not be able to stop them, brave sister.
He'd always admired her ferocity. Even as a child, determination swam through her veins more than anyone he knew. She wasn't afraid to stand up to anyone, no matter their size or magic capabilities. Out of all his siblings, she was the only one who openly called their father out when she disagreed with his decisions. She had being Daddy's little girl on her side, his wrath never finding its aim at her, but it still showed her daring nature. Arya shifted in her seat.
As you said, you have protection wards up. I've done my best to convince Ashley staying here is for the best. For now, she understands.
And what about her boyfriend?
Arya raised an eyebrow.
Interested in a mortal relationship? Really, where is my brother?
Ha ha.
I plan to visit Scarlett soon, and I'd like to update her.
Arya's lips curved upwards.
Oh, Scarlett. That's right.
Don't give me that look.
Kaelem adjusted his cuff.
You can tell her Ashley's trying to understand. But I can only do so much.
Something clicked against Kaelem's mind, like a knock on a door. He reached out.
Company.
Lola's voice played in his mind.
The Sealy advisor is here for you.
Looks like Lyke has blessed us with a surprise visit.
Kaelem said to Arya.
Hopefully he's here to tell me the Sealy queen agrees to my request of a formal alliance.
Arya shrugged.
Do things ever work out as you plan?
Kaelem didn't answer.
Send him to the parlor.
When Kaelem entered the parlor, Lyke sat in a red chair next to the fireplace, surrounded by marble tile, a fire burning in the hearth.
I was cold.
Lyke stared at the flames.
And it's so dark around here. 'Tis the reality of the night court.
Kaelem walked to the bar and made himself a mixed drink.
What can I get you?
Surprise me. Kaelem made like the same drink and handed it to him before sitting. Though he didn't spend a lot of time in the parlor, he'd always loved it. The black and white artwork stood out sharply from the purple walls. It was fun and sophisticated, both qualities Kaelem enjoyed in the Unseelie court. He'd redone the entire interior once he gained the throne, bringing in a well-known designer from one of the mortal shows he watched on TV. Kaelem pressed his mental ability outwards. Nothing. Lyke's wards were so strong, Kaelem wouldn't have been able to sense his presence at all. Strange. All Fae had the ability to block out invading minds from their own. Some were more gifted at the ability than others, but few could keep their mind's entire existence hidden. It was an ability usually reserved for the strongest unseelie. It wasn't unheard of for a seelie, though. Just rare. And it meant Lyke was powerful. Kaelem shouldn't be surprised. Only the strongest would be chosen as Genevieve's advisor. Having strong mental shields was an important asset. It meant the seelie queen could confide in him with confidence. Lyke had been her most trusted subject much longer than Kaelem had been alive.
Has your queen sent you to agree to my request to ally with one another?
Kaelem sipped his drink. Fruity, with a little kick of vodka. Delicious. Lyke took a gulp.
No, she is still deliberating.
I see,
Kaelem said.
And she sent you here too. I came on my own.
He took another drink. This drink is quite delectable.
A mortal recipe?
Yes. Sex on the Beach. A fun title, don't you think? Does your duty as advisor take you to the mortal world often?
Despite being in the mortal realm, the Seelie and Unseelie courts weren't actually part of the human world. They were hidden and only intermingled with mortals when they wanted to. Like when a king was in desperate need for decorating advice. Kaelem thought of the flicker of Scarlett's mom he'd seen in Lyke's mind when he'd visited the Seelie court. The image moved like he'd seen her in person, not stale like a memory or a photograph would be. And she was younger than in the picture Kaelem had seen. He wanted to ask Lyke how he'd known her, but moving too boldly with the information wasn't smart. Kaelem needed to play this game right.
When necessary. The queen likes to keep up to date with the ongoings of the human world. Of course, as do I.
Unlike the Seelie court, the Unseelie court welcomed select humans into its world as guests. While Kaelem had no desire for mortality, he did find human life interesting. Lyke finished his drink.
I'm here to learn more about the new situation.
Situation?
Kaelem stood.
Another?
Yes, please.
Lyke handed his empty glass to Kaelem.
My queen is skeptical of the story you told her about the Fates and the She.
And you? Do you believe me?
I gave you the information that led you there. And it doesn't surprise me that the Fates have had ulterior motives this whole time.
Lyke's gaze dropped to the floor. His right fist momentarily clenched before his fingers spread out and he relaxed his arm. Kaelem refilled Lyke's drink and topped off his own.
I told you what happened. We went through the portal and were trapped there. We traveled to the island's center, and when we arrived at the power, the Fates showed up. We fought them and Scarlett took the power. Then they took Raith and left.
It was the quick version, but did the details really matter? Kaelem wasn't usually so open and honest with people outside his trusted circle, but if he wanted Lyke to put his faith in him, then he would need to be as truthful as he could.
And Scarlett got the power they prophesied?
Yes.
Kaelem remembered the knife she lodged into his back to keep him from taking it.
By doing so, she became the realm's queen.
He thought about how she looked after she'd healed him. Her skin, now tattooed in white, glowed with magic. Such a change from the human she'd been when he'd met her.
You believe the Fates wanted this power for themselves?
I'm not sure.
At first, Kaelem figured they took Raith out of anger after Scarlett had taken the power for herself. But then, after more thought, he wondered if that had been their plan all along.
Part of me thinks they wanted Scarlett to be the one to get it. You're saying they're using her?
It's possible.
Kaelem handed Lyke his refilled drink.
There's so little we know about them, or about the Sidhe. Even Scarlett's power is an unknown.
Lyke's eyes met Kaelem's, and he saw the worry in his gaze.
How is she handling it?
She's tough, but it's a lot for her to take in. Her heart is still mortal, and as you know, we Fae aren't like the humans.
No, we're not.
Despite our differences, our courts will be stronger united, Kaelem said.
My father was never able to look past our differences. It isn't in our courts to trust one another, but I believe to prepare ourselves for what's coming, we must.
And what about the recent history between our courts? Is there any room for an alliance?
I don't have to like your queen to respect her power.
It isn't unheard of for our courts to have common interests. A smirk crept onto Lyke's lips. He finished his drink and stood. Thank you for the visit. I will return home and do what I can to convince my queen to believe what you say. Kaelem didn't try to pry into Lyke's mind again. But now, more than ever, he knew Lyke's interest in Scarlett went further than gaining information for his queen. Raith waited in the bedroom he'd been given to stay in. It was plain, with stone walls and a bed frame made of black wood. A fireplace lit the room and offered him some warmth in the otherwise cold realm. It was a different chill than the one he felt in the winter court. There was no ice here, but an essence of death permeated the air. It didn't bother him. Nothing did. He did as the fates asked, and when he wasn't needed, spent most of his time in his room doing nothing, unless he had a visitor. He remembered the events of the past months. Losing to his brother in the battle, searching for and finding his mother, but something seemed to be missing from his recollection. The door swung open, and Decuma, the middle fate, and his special visitor entered. She walked straight to Raith and wrapped her arms around his neck, pulling him close and pressing her lips to his. After a long kiss, she said,
Come, father wants to meet you.
She turned and left the room. Raith obliged, following her through the hallway. There were no paintings on the walls. Lanterns every 10 feet gave just enough light to see the stone covering the ground. The hallway led to a staircase down to the main floor, where the throne room was located. Across the room was an empty black throne, high-backed and embellished with a border of garnets. In front, a large fire pit currently sat empty. Windows were evenly spaced on two of the walls, giving a view to the gray skies outside. Morta, the oldest fate, and Nona, the youngest, waited to one side of the pit. All three of the fates wore long dresses covered in black atop the black fabric underneath. Though they all looked similar, Raith was able to tell them apart. Both Morta and Decuma wore their dark hair down, but Morta's eyes were narrower and slightly more almond-shaped than Decuma's. He'd gotten to know Decuma's gaze quite well during his time in the Darkland. She'd come to him the first night in the castle. Nona, the quietest of the three, kept her hair in a bun. She was also the prettiest, with large eyes and high cheekbones, but she kept her distance from him.
Father will be here soon,
Morta said.
We have an important task for you, Raith.
Very well.
Our plans with our allies are moving into motion. Now we need the Otherworld Queen.
Raith knew who she was. He'd been her ally at one point, but memories of her were fuzzy.
What do you need from me?
Your memory was damaged by Ilani when you crossed the Spirit Lake. But you and Scarlett had been close once. She will trust you.
Raith remembered going through the lake to get to the tree where he joined with the Fates.
He couldn't remember why he changed sides. It was odd, but it didn't bother him.
How will I find her?
We will come up with a plan soon.
A man in a cloak appeared on the throne, wine glass in hand. He took a sip.
Hello, daughters.
His dark hair was cropped short, and he looked younger than Raith had imagined he would. The Fates bowed. Raith did too. No need to make this guy mad.
So, you're the one my daughters have selected. I'm Anku, King of the Darkland.
He stood and circled Raith.
Very well. And he can get her.
Dekuma stepped toward her father.
They were close once.
She looked at Raith with pursed lips. Anku raised an eyebrow.
I see. We all know how closeness toys with the mind. It seems he was the right choice.
Dekuma and Morta both grinned. Nona lingered in the back.
Nona, darling, do you agree with your sisters? Will their plan work?
Nona smiled.
Yes, father. My sisters are wise.
Anku finished his glass of wine.
Then it's settled. When the opportunity is right, send Raith in and bring me the Otherworld Queen.
Chapter 3. Scarlett stirred the food on her plate. Purple potatoes, the ripest fruit, poultry of some sort. It was even more delicious than Fae food, but she'd only eaten a third of it. Now, all mixed, it looked completely unappetizing. The dining room sat in the east wing of the castle, in a turret with the highest ceiling she had ever seen. A circular stone table sat in the room, a long silver runner lining its middle. A glass vase with an assortment of white flowers decorated the center. Scarlet's skin absorbed the sunlight pouring in through the skylight above. She closed her eyes and soaked it in. Serenity washed over her.
As beautiful as ever, darling.
Kaelem's voice echoed through the room. When Scarlet opened her eyes, Kaelem was sitting across from her with his feet on the table.
And you're as proper as ever,
Scarlet replied.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.